This song is for those that know without a doubt in their mind, I made it out all right.
Amen and amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It's grateful to see you on tonight. And thank you for your diligence. You know me, whether it's 2 or 32, whether it's 32 or 3200, I'm going to teach the word about what God has given me for the saints of God. This is where we put up our shouting shoes and open up our minds to be able to receive what the Lord would have for us to know. I want to start tonight in 3 John 1 and 2 with a promise from the Lord. 3 John chapter 1 verse 2, you can peruse over there. If not, you can look at the closest screen that is close to you. And the title of our seminar over the next 4 weeks is going to be dealing with living without sickness. My heart and my desire is that the Lord has not only died to save your soul, He died to save your stomach. All right, let me say it again. God just did not die to save us from our sins. He died to save us from our stomach. And we're going to get off into that and really show you in the Word of God that God, this is a revelation that God has graced unto me and wants to help us as a people. Look up here, you do know black people are dying before their time. In Africa, I'm blessed to be able to travel, and many of the sicknesses that our people deal with in America, they don't deal with over there. And what it is a very high influx of our culture. And that is, we all can agree, America gets rich off the sick. I said America gets rich off the sick. There's a piece of literature in the scripture that talks about a woman with an issue of blood, and how this woman had went to the doctors. And when she got to the doctors, y'all know the story, what happened. She had given all the money she had. Amen. And when she gave all the money she had, watch this, they still couldn't fix her. And that is the answer to our American system, our healthcare system. They are not taught to heal. They are taught to maintain your sickness, to keep you coming back over and over and over again. And so we're going to look at the Holy Scriptures, because the habits and things that we have as a people have to be taught away from us, because it's just not a teaching, it's a way of living. Like my half a ham story. Y'all have heard that before. The half ham story is a girl get married and then she finally goes with her husband, and the husband sees her cut half of the ham and throw it in the trash. He says, honey, that is the good part of the ham. Why are you throwing that part of the ham away? She says, you need to just stick to working, because you don't know anything about cooking. My mother taught me how to make a ham, and she showed me how to do this ham. He said, well, if your mama showed you how to ham, your mama can't cook. So they began to argue in the kitchen, and all of a sudden they was getting ready to go over and be with her mother for Thanksgiving. And when they got there, she said, mama, tell this fool that I know exactly how what I'm doing when I cut this ham and I put it where it needs to be. And her mother looked back at the door and she says, honey, the only reason I cut that part of the ham off is because my pen was too small. She took it as a way of life, and that's what we do. We take the way of things that are being done and how difficult it is. The reason why the fast is so difficult is because we are so dogmatic in the way we must have our food, right? And when we do that, we don't actually know that the habits that we have as a cultural people is for sickness and things that are for grade. Now, it freaks you out when they show you something on social media about them injecting chickens. And you look at how they inject these chickens. Well, they have to see, when people have a demand on them, they will cheat and do what's wrong for the sake of money. And they will stamp a cow, a chicken, and all that stuff as grade A. What happens? Well, you get it at grade A in the supermarket, but by the time you unwrap it at home, they got a commercial. that says we just found out that that half truckload of chickens that we sent out are sick. That's after everybody has already indulged in the chicken. And therefore, many of the diseases that we're dying from is from sick animals. And so I want to teach tonight from a godly perspective, and my hope over the 4 weeks is that you will consider changing your lifestyle of eating. Because again, God did just not save you from your sins, He saved you from your good. Okay. 3 John chapter 1, verse 2, there on your screen, he says, "Beloved," read it with me, "I wish above all things," he's when all things is a connotation, if you make it a notation, all things means spiritual things. It's just not all things, cars, clothes, monies, and houses, and cribs. All things is actually a notation for spiritual things. He says that you prosper and be in health. Now, let me look at that word beloved there. You see it? The word beloved, it simply means this: the one who has the power to give you control. Those are those who have received Jesus Christ in the pardon of your sin. He just didn't again save you from your sin, but He gave you power. That power just not go listen and speaking in tongue and laying hands. That power is when chicken is in front of you. Amen. That power is when you fool. And to tell that food that's in front of you, "I shall eat no more. My body has reached its capacity." But the scriptures are many times not taught from a standpoint of control. It's taught from a standpoint of marketing. Speaking in tongue and dancing when the Holy Ghost comes. Sometimes the Holy Ghost will tell you, "Don't eat." Okay. And so he says, beloved. He's talking about those that are in the Lord, who are sensitive to the voice of the Lord. He says, "I wish," or "I pray," above what? Above all. He said this, before you consider bucking, shouting, speaking in tongue, he says, just know what my promise and will is for your life. Here it is. That you prosper and, come on, be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Now underline that word soul prosper. This is the notation that I want you to write down, and that is, the soul is my emotional system. All right? The soul is my emotional system. Would you say that with me? My soul is my emotional system. Look up here. How many of y'all eat real good when you're emotional? Eat real good. Now, don't lie now, because when a woman is on her menstrual cycle, she is as emotional as she will ever be. And when they do that now, because I even catch First Lady sneaking Snicker bars. And she's saying, "Listen, you, hey, this is my time, don't bother me, Michael Clay." Because when a woman is emotional, she's driven. More women than more men, they're driven to eat, right? When a woman is emotional, she don't need a man, she need a sack of Oreos. Or some hard cookies. Y'all gonna help me here? Chewy. Don't want the chewy, give me the hard kind with a little milk.
Yes, sir.
All right, I got help tonight. Y'all walk with me. All right, write this down. My emotions is the encourager of my eating. My emotional system is the encourager of my eating. Right? Emotional eating is a way you can suppress and try to soothe negative emotion. Right? Girl gets a divorce, girlfriends come over, what she says? "Let's go eat." Right? "And we're gonna eat all night." I was eating at before the fast, I was trying to get that last buffet in. And I was eating at one of the breakfast places there in Houston. When I got there, it was about 3 soul sisters that needed 2 seats for 2 cheeks. Y'all ain't gonna say amen. Y'all come on, I'm gonna help you tonight and bless you. Amen. Did you just lean over and whisper that to your neighbor? Say, "Neighbor, did you hear what he said? She needed 2 seats for 2 cheeks. I got help tonight." And I'm telling them, chairs was in a string. And she was grinding. You know, she wasn't sitting there like this. She was sitting where it just caught the edge of that cheek. She was way back here because her stomach couldn't get to the table. And I'm trying to help somebody tonight because, watch this. You can think this is, I know it's going to a little bit, it's funny because it's going to be sad when I get to it. All right? But I'm looking at this lady and I'm looking at when she puts down, she had grits and hash browns, a side of bacon, sausage, 4 pancakes. Y'all ain't gonna say amen to this? OJ. And then she asked, man, the woman said, do you want me to get you another glass of orange juice? She says, no, just give me a water to go. I'm thinking, what is that water gonna do, honey? And when she was getting up, her girlfriend had to come on her side of the table and get under her arm to help her up. And I'm saying this because you have friends and relatives, people you went to school on oxygen, in wheelchairs, fat. All right? And then what we do as a society, we make allowances for it. Okay? I'm counseling now, and I'm telling saints all the time, can you get lap band? And they're like, Pastor, you think I ought to have it? I said, you can't carry that kind of weight into your 50s and 60s. Amen. So too much weight, make this notation. Find out how much weight you are and multiply it by 6. That's the type of weight that's on your knees. So if you're 100 pounds, you do that times 6, that's how much pressure is on your knees. 600 pounds of pressure. Did you know that? It's hard. And when you carry for a long time, you don't know how to tax it. They don't even talk about working on concrete for years and certain things and such. You will wear those knees out. Ain't nobody going to say amen. It's because this is not the shouting kind of teaching you're going to get tonight. But your emotional system is driven by a lot of this. What are some emotional things that you need to recognize? Here are some variables. Stress. Anger. I'm afraid. Boredom. Is anybody here eat because you're bored? Just in the kitchen. Now that's all right when your metabolism is like this. But when your metabolism slow down, two babies and a piece of chicken, I'm telling you. That metabolism will slow down. Here it is, sadness. Now watch how we are culturally. What is the one thing Negroes do when they lose somebody they love? Don't we drown you in food. We bring chicken by the house, out there frying ribs. We doing everything, sweet potatoes, spaghetti. Because we want to say this, we know we can't take that pain away, but this chicken can. And we in the line, just big as we want to be. Help and get in the casket we just walked past. Alright? And then loneliness. I heard a fellow tell a girl one time, honey, you don't need a man. You got enough chicken in your refrigerator to last you till Jesus comes. Are you with me? It's just talking about, this is what I want you to really ask yourself tonight. How healthy am I emotionally? It makes all the difference in the world. Because my emotions is going to play into my appetite. Psychologist 101 says emotional eating is a way we suppress and smooth negative emotions such as stress, anger, fear, boredom, sadness, and loneliness. Let me give you a biblical example of emotional eating. Okay? Genesis chapter 25. You get an opportunity to come and go there with me. Go back to Genesis 25 verse 29. Genesis 25 and 29. 25, 29. Next screen, if you will. Here's an example of emotional eating. Anybody remember the story of Esau and Jacob? Okay. The Bible says in verse 29, once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau came in from the field and he was what? Say it again. He was what? You see that? How many of you exhausted? You didn't work all day. Right? Some of us have horrible habits. I know I'm one. When I work all day, I don't want no food. It'll feel like it'll slow me down. But look how many hours I go without food. And then when we get out of work, what we want? Rice, biscuits, fried chicken. Put some jelly on that biscuits and butter. It's 8:30, 9 o'clock. Now, if you don't think you snore, you gonna snore that night. When all that food is sitting on your heart. Lady Brown says, choking in your sleep. Y'all better quit. He was exhausted. Verse 30 said, and Esau said to Jacob, what did he say? Let me eat some of that red stew, for I'm exhausted. Therefore, his name was called Edom. Now, make a notation right there. Edom means one who is controlled by their appetite. Controlled by their appetite. One who is controlled by their appetite. Verse 31, Jacob said, I'll give you the stew if you exchange it something for me. And what did he exchange it with him for? Everybody say birthright. Now make this notation, my birthright is my privilege. It's my privilege, P-R-I-V-I-L-E-G-E. It is my privilege. Say it with me, my birthright is my privilege. Well, what is the privilege of a believer? Do you know? You thought, what is it, going to heaven? Do you think that's the privilege of the believer? Can I show you what it is? Here it is. It's in Psalm 91, verse 16. It's there on your screen. You can make a notation of it. Psalm 91, verse 16. I want you to write that down because I want you to read it with me. Right? Read it with me. With a long life, I will satisfy him and let him see. Listen again. With a, the Lord says what? I will what? And let him what? So what is the birthright for you? What's the privilege? Long life. The believer is supposed to live a long life. Only thing that can get in the way of a believer living a long time is supposed to be only their witness. That brings you in a place where some sisters, the saints didn't eat meat. Matter of fact, Samson and John the Baptist were Nazarites. They were not permitted to cut their hair nor eat of certain foods. We see it in Daniel chapter 3, what happened when the three Hebrew boys, Mishael, Azariah, right? When the three Hebrew boys told the king, Asari, we don't eat meat. He said, what do you mean? You're going to turn down my meat? He said, yes, I bet you in 10 days, if we would just eat beans and vegetables, we'll look 10 times sexier than your guys. He said, let's have the test. They came back in 10 days. God's men look stronger. Their face were more radiant than those of the world. And the king changed the diet based upon their discipline. Y'all see this? When God wanted to kill mankind off, what did he do? And when they come out of Egypt, this is what God says. I'm going to feed y'all manna. They got mad. And said, we have been used to eating neck bones, ribs. We've been eating all this meat in Egypt. You're going to get us out here and kill us. And then God says to them, well, what do you want to eat? They said, we want meat. The Lord looked at Moses and said, I'm going to give these Negroes as much meat until they come out of their nose. I said, because that's the attitude in which God gave them. Now, you may say, well, what's wrong with eating meat? They used to live 900 years old. When they started eating meat, they died at 70. And I'm explaining that, hopefully I have an opportunity to explain the whole meat concept to you and what it does as it relates to the 9 feet of intestines that you have. Okay? But what is the privilege of the believer is what? Long life. Suggests that God ties the control of our blessing, of our bellies to our blessing. Say with me, my belly is connected to my blessing. What kind of belly do you have? Can I ask you that? What kind of belly do you have? Don't answer. I'm going to do it because in the scriptures, God many times would label the name or ideas of churches by their bellies. Titus chapter 1 verse 12. You're taking a note again. You'll be able to have this uploaded to you and sent to you because I want you to rehearse it. I want you to get it. Titus 1 and 12 is talking about a church down there in Crete. C-R-E-T-E. It was a church in the city of Crete. My way, they were down there, Maury. One of the elders went to the churches and he noticed something. He says, this is a dry church. It was a dry church, no hand clapping, no foot stomping. Well, number one is because they never fasted, okay? But the second thing that he noticed in there was the size of their bellies. These some women and men in here with some guts. All right? Now let's read, because what are slow belly people? Now go over to Titus chapter 1 verse 12. Titus chapter 1 verse 12. I want you to go over there and I actually want you to lay eyes on it. Titus 1 and 12, and it's going to be a blessing to your heart. It says, one of Crete's own, call them the Cretans, they are nothing more than liars. They are evil brutes and lazy gluttons. He identified a church by their belly, the size of their belly. He called them slow bellies. Repeat after me, the church of the slow belly. Praise God. That was prophetic, because what he was suggesting the elder that went down to this church in Crete was that they was a lazy church spiritually. I don't want our church to be a lazy church spiritually. Why you think the praise was so crazy today? It was because, watch this, you have given yourself over to control your belly. When you do that, God arrests us, because out of that belly shall flow rivers of living water. Well, it's hard for the rivers to get going if meat is in there. Y'all ain't gonna say amen. It's hard to shout when you a glutton. Listen, when I went to leaping in the pulpit today, I felt so much joy and liberty in my legs and my heart. My God, I'm telling you, I can feel God's presence. Because, listen to this, he says this there on your screen. It says, what is a glutton? An excessively greedy eater. Won't you do me a favor and find somebody close to you and just say, neighbor, can me and you be honest? I want to ask you a question. Are you an excessively greedy eater? Get an answer now. So he identified that the church was named by the size of their belly. They were slow bellies. And slow belly churches are, watch this, are lazy spiritually. Now, this is the Sabbath of the Lord's Day. I'll teach this across the country one day. And I'll pack out seminars on people who want to know this kind of teaching. Right? I don't have any shame to anyone that is not here to get this kind of teaching. Because I'm going to teach you in a minute. When you don't, you avoid of this kind of teaching, Eric, the scripture teaches in 1 Corinthians, we get there in a minute, how many saints will die before their time. Yes, they will. If you look in your family, there are some people today still should be alive. They ate themselves to a bad heart. Now, ain't nobody gonna say that in the family. Oh, they just got old. No, they still should be living. They were obese, and they, listen, there are some relatives I know where the doctor said their heart can't beat through that fat no more. They got to die. And these things we've been taught, fat back, salt meat, salt. They say this one white girl has killed more black men than any black man could. I done saw it. So I started there and talking about, and let's go back to Genesis 25 and 29. I want to pick up there at the end of 31. Now you already wrote down Genesis 25, 29 through 34 with Jacob and Esau. I told you Esau was a man known for his appetite, and he exchanged his birthright, which was, what was the birthright? His privilege. What's the privilege of the believer? Y'all talk to me. Long life. He exchanged his long life for a pot of stew. All right, so I want to pick back up there at 32. Read there, it's there on your screen. Esau said, man, I'm about to die. Of what use is my birthright to me? Now look at this. He's ready to exchange his privilege, Eric, for some food. Jacob said, just swear to me. And he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Verse 34, then Jacob gave Esau what? Bread and bean stew. He ate and drank and rose and went on his way. Then Esau, underline that word in your Bible, despised his birthright. Everybody say despised. Now what is despised? Make this notation. It simply means, he despised means this, it means his thinking towards food changed. How many of y'all in the priorities or the top five priorities, Mari, do you have in your top five food? Let me see my show of hands tonight. And your top five food is at least about two. Now don't, y'all don't have to lie, I'm not setting you up, but you listen. If your attitude's getting ready to get bad, you home. Thank you, Missionary Brown. You get ready to slap everybody, you mad. Hey, when we gonna eat? Y'all remember the Christmas play with the young people? Remember they was doing that? I put that in there and y'all started laughing, tickled, because y'all know that's how we are. Now we hear y'all fussing, but then one of the kids said, well, okay, y'all fussing, but when are we gonna eat? Some of y'all have the worst attitude. You get out of school and certain things you had need, you all, you won't even speak to somebody feeds you. What you laughing for, Mark? Because if we control our appetite, then, brothers and sisters, then we have to be cognitive of how we think towards food. How many will eat anything when you're hungry? Now, some of y'all are older, but when you were younger, you would. And now, you know, you have places like Sims, and I know somebody from Sims may see this across the country, but Sims just got some good sauce. But the meat under there ain't always right. Y'all got quiet. But see, when you hungry, and they put that mustardine sauce on that meat with that bread, oh, in a sweet tea with enough sugar to bat your eye, you gonna go crazy. Put your thumb in your belly button and say, oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. Y'all ain't gonna say amen to that. 1 Corinthians 11:29, write that down. It says this, for those who eat and drink, read that with me there on your screen. Just make a notation again, this will be recorded. Read it with me. For those who eat and drink without what? Just stop right there. Do you ever take a moment and just look what's in front of you? Now it's all right for us to say amen, yes sir, and that. But wait till I start talking about the processed foods of fries and chicken wings and nuggets and stuff from fast food. Wait till I tell you about the salt content in it. And the things in the food that make your pancreas go dead. Wow. Because you're saying, I take consideration as long as I got me a biggie fry. Right, boys? A 5 for $5 with some hamburger that Joe, watch this. The hamburger at the process, your body can't even break that down. That's why you sweating in the night when you eat one of them. Your stomach saying, we cannot tear this meat down. And then you leave you on the toilet and then, I'm here for y'all tonight. Because you wonder why. Now you're on the fast, you don't have no problem going to the pot. Matter of fact, you run, your feet run through the house like you try. I'ma help y'all tonight. Y'all ain't gonna lie to me. I'm coming to get you right in your head. Now when your gut healthy, your butt is hurting. Then you run out of toilet paper. And run up and get some more toilet paper. Who using all toilet paper this fast? Because it puts the body in the natural way. And one of the segments I'm gonna talk about is elimination. And how your body is supposed to get rid of food 3 hours after you eat. If it don't, that means you deprive that body of water. And you don't eat enough food that has safe passage. And we'll talk about that soon. It's going to be a blessing to you. But let's read. For those who don't have discernment, raise your right hand and say, Lord, help me to have discernment of the food that I eat in Jesus' name. He says discernment because discernment brings honor to the body. He says, if not, then it should be bring. You will bring judgment on themselves. Well, what is the judgment, brothers and sisters? Say it with me. Premature death. Y'all know what that means? It means you're going to die before your time. If you don't have discernment on the food in front of you. Now, Solomon says it. I'm going to give it to you. Holy Spirit just gave it to me. When Solomon in Proverbs 23:2, just write it down. Proverbs 23:2 says, if you sit down to eat with a king and you can't control your appetite, it says, take that butter knife and put it to your throat and kill yourself. He's saying you're not going to even put yourself in a place to have control for the king to bless you because you can't hear what he's saying. You ever been talking to somebody and they can't hear you because they eat? How many raise your hand and say the worst time talking to you when you eat? You won't remember nothing. I can tell you it's $1 million under your pillow. You won't hear me. It's $1 million pillow. And this is what Solomon's saying. He says a man is so controlled by his appetite it'll shut off his senses. Amazing revelation. I decree unto you, if you embrace this teaching, you won't die before your time. Amen. No heart condition. Now look up here. Some of you may not can handle this, but animals don't die from the same diseases that we do. Animals don't have heart attacks. They have did a diagnostic scientific fact, Brother Jordan, that the only animals that die like humans are only those who receive injections like humans. So the needles and the things and the medicine that we take here do more damage to us than just natural. Let me prove it to you. We have a member in our church named Sister Sandra King. Her mother was sent home to die almost a year ago. The doctor said we can't do nothing else with her. Take her home into hospice to die. Today she's still living. She's eating greens and sweet potatoes and she's eating a healthy diet with a salad. And this woman is still alive. And y'all may not can handle this, but I say it like this. She lived longer because she got away from the doctor. Let's keep going. Now, the believer, Eric, has to embrace this next truth, and that is Matthew 4:4. And this is what we're doing on the fast. And I want you to write over to the side, I must live a life of fasting. And I'm going to challenge you to fast 2 days a week for the rest of your life. You too, little man. Mara saying me? Yeah, you too. Say that with me, twice a week. Now my pastor, he died about 84. But he could have died about 90, but he wanted to have his cataract surgery. He had it, but he didn't wake up. Dr. J.W. Harrison. But J.W. Harrison would put the saints on the fast twice a week, Tuesdays and Fridays. They would fast on Tuesdays and Fridays. Now let me help you because of what my doctor said to me. My doctor said, Mike, you got good results. He says, I'm just afraid you're using up all the reserves. He said, you know, because you're heavy and you hide it in your height, he said, but you're using up too much reserves. It would do you good to lose 20 pounds. Now, I have to turn the gun on myself to get you to turn it on you. And what he was suggesting to me is the fact you do too much in excess. And I thought about that thing, Samantha, and I said, you know what? He tells me the truth. I'm not satisfied with one glass of tea. Half of the pitcher of that tea gonna be gone when I get to it. I'm gonna sip on that tea all day. I learned that from my dad. My mom's right here. My mom could not keep enough tea in the refrigerator for us. Country men drinking tea. That's relaxing. All right, now don't throw me in the trash because some of y'all and salt have a different relationship. Cokes. But salt, you're addicted to it. Now you won't pick up the salt, but you'll eat a whole bucket of popcorn. We got some witnesses in here tonight. Okay? So don't throw my sweet tea in the trash. All of us, everybody. Amen. Some of you just got a sweet tooth. You cute, you try to control your weight, but all your teeth is half missing. Just 59 going on zero. You know, them Skittles are tearing them teeth up. Y'all ain't gonna say amen. Read with me, but man should not what? Live. Everybody say alone. That's the key word. He says you gotta have something that's a supplement to that food. But every word that what? Cometh from what? How many of you will starve yourself to hear from God? Not many. Matthew 5 says, he that hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled. Many times God don't speak to you because your belly too big. How do I know that's true? 1 Samuel chapter 3, let me give you a different revelation because the Bible talks about a boy there by the name of Samuel who lived in the temple. And Sister Elise, he lived in the temple and he served under the priest named Eli. The Bible says Eli was the priest, but he couldn't hear God because he got fat. Matter of fact, when he died, he fell over in the back of his chair because the Bible says he was so heavy, he strangled himself. Now, you know you fat if you fall back in your chair and kill yourself. I'm going to throw this mic, y'all going to say amen. Amen. Just touch somebody close to him and say, that's pretty heavy. That's. There's a guy on TV, Bishop, somebody won't say his name. I don't want nobody to be offended watching this across the world. And he was preaching in a handicap chair at 450 pounds. Talking about miracle signs and wonders. And somebody stood up in the service and said, we probably could see some if you would fast. Y'all got quiet. Man should not live by bread alone, but what? Every word that what? Raise your right hand and say this after me. The Lord wants me to have a healthy soul and spirit and not be sustained by flesh alone. I want you to receive that. You got a whole lot of healthy food, but your soul is nasty. And I told you that the number one encourager of food eating is what? Emotions. And when your emotions are negative, you don't feel good, oh Lord, they're gonna cut the lights on. First place you going, somebody bring me something out the kitchen. Praise the Lord. Snicker bars, Twinkies, just, y'all ain't gonna say, chocolate cookies. I got a witness in here. It's quiet. But let's read some scriptures. I think that when this is all foundational stuff, it's 12 truths I'm gonna give to you, but I'm laying foundation on tonight. Proverbs 18:14. I'm trying to fill you up on the word of God. Proverbs 18:14. Will you read that with me tonight? It simply says, the human spirit can't endure what? But a crushed spirit, the Bible says, who can bear? Now that lets you know that the health of your spirit will determine how you handle sickness. There are some people that get diagnosed with cancer and they beat cancer, not living. We have a woman in our church by the name of Dorothy Dyer. You want to know why Dorothy Dyer overcome cancer? Because she's a happy woman. Y'all miss me. A merry heart is good medicine. It's medicine you can't buy in the store. When you're going through something, it's not the time for you to get sad. It's that time for you to get glad. Amen. And if you're a study of medicine, they are now adding psych evaluations to sick cancer patients. Evaluating the soul if it was bitter or not. Bitterness can attract sickness in your body. Now you can keep holding grudges if you want to, but they'll make you sick. Bitterness literally in scripture releases sickness and poisons in your body. Negative chemicals to take over your body. When you worry and bitter, your urine is darker. Y'all better say amen. You get worried if you want to and go to the bathroom and see. I'm talking about with water. Okay. It's teaching us the human spirit can endure anything, but if you crush them emotionally, they can't bear nothing. That's why when they tell folks, ma'am, you got cancer, you got 6 months. If they're not emotionally strong enough, they'll die before they even leave the hospital. Jeremiah 30:17. Write that down. Jeremiah 30:17. Look there on your screen. Read it with me. He says, I will restore healing unto you and heal thee of what? Now underline that word thy, if you ever get it, or make a notation thy. Now whose wounds are those? Do you not know that you have some self-inflicted wounds in you that you created? But your God is so amazing that he says this, I want to heal you anyway. I love that. Lay hand on your bosom and say, Lord wants to heal me. And he will. Jeremiah 33:6, write that down. It says, behold, I will bring it, are you there? Read with me, health and cure. It's on your screen. And I will cure them. And will reveal unto them the abundance of what? Peace and truth. Now, truth has everything to do with the diagnostics of your body. I ain't going to no doctor. You at least need to tell, they need to tell you what's wrong with you. Now, whether you get the medication or not, that's on you. But you need at least for them to put you on the machine to tell you what's wrong with you. That's true. But God says, I can reveal unto you how the abundance of peace. This morning I was talking about this ancient herb called bitter leaf that targets and rips high blood pressure right out of the body. How one of our members is just really enjoying bitter leaf. Well, that's what that abundance of peace, the Lord said, I'll reveal it to you. In other words, God got some herbal remedies, some natural things that will heal your body. That even get you off of dialysis. Reverse the strength of the kidney. But they never do that. They just want you to be on it all the days of your life. But if you want to be healed, then God will reveal. Say it with me. If I want to be healed, God will reveal. How many believe that tonight? Jeremiah 8:22. Make that notation. Again, I'll send it to you. Read it with me there on the screen. Is there no balm in Gilead? He says this, Is there no physician there? Is there no physician there? Look what he asks. Then why then is not the health of my daughter of my people recovered? Look at verse 6. He's saying this. If there's a doctor in town, why are my people getting sick? And there, if there's a natural herbal remedy to fix them, why are they not doing better? You want to know why? Because it's not revealed to us. Bitter leaf is not even sold in the United States. Now, if bitter leaf can cure high blood pressure, why wouldn't they sell it? You want to know why? And why won't they market it in America? They want you sick. Because somebody's eating off your sickness. This is powerful. This is powerful. I want you to try something. Make this notation. I want you to try to take a natural okra. This is your assignment. Natural okra. When you cut that okra open, I want you to take two of them. I want you to pull all the slime out of it and put it in a cup. Now, it don't taste like nothing. It's just your emotions that's messing with you. It don't taste like anything. I want you to put water in it. And I just want you to drink a tall glass of okra slime water. It don't have no taste. It's just in your mind. But I want you to see what it's going to do to your body. Just try it. Because everything that God made to heal man and woman, he put it from the earth. Now watch this. Some of y'all are hypocritical. Y'all would fry over. You chop that okra and put that fried okra. And Eric, y'all better help me with some French fries. Oh man, two pieces of catfish. That's a meal. Or some people boil that okra. Or do it like that raw and eat it. Eat okra just by itself. But okra naturally has healing in it. I'm going to reveal many things to you throughout these 4 weeks of teaching. When my time is up, I'm done. I'm cutting off. But I'm going to do it in 4 weeks. This is going to be an archive. We're recording. This is going to be things you can play back in your life. I challenge you to fast twice a week. It don't have to be the whole 24 hours, but you have to mark that time that you don't eat. Because you need time for your body to rid the food you already eat. And many times in the process of us eating every day, especially when I get to talking about the kind of foods we eat, those are foods that don't move too fast in your stomach. And when they don't move too fast in your stomach, I'm going to teach you the law that was in Leviticus 19 about food being in your stomach too long is an abomination. Because the Bible says, Samantha, it's not a peace offering. A peace offering would be something like cabbage. You can eat cabbage, and cabbage will come right out of you as whole as it was when it went in. Turn around and look. Raise your right hand. Say this with me. I pledge allegiance that I will start looking at my poop in Jesus' name. I'm helping to heal y'all today. Now, you eat stuff like that, it come right out of you whole because it got legs on it. And I'll talk about that soon. But he says this, if there's a bomb in Gilead and there's a physician there, then why are my people not recovering? Because just like the Pharisees were keeping the people spiritually blind, physicians are keeping people naturally sick. The man leaves right out with you on the scale. There's a pharmacist, there's a pharmacology. That's a study of it. He's not a pharmacist, he sells medicine. He leaves out from the doctor. You on your way in. You go in, talk about your head hurting. He has this new thing, and everyone he sells, he gets a kickback of $50. He sell you 50 pills, $50 on 50 pills, that's some money. He's telling you, try this for 30 days. Try it. The reason why he says try it is because the physician is ignorant of healing. He only practices medicine. Okay. Y'all gonna get this? So this is what I want you to do tonight. I'm almost through with my first segment, and that is make this notation and write this down. Personal responsibility. getting ready to get off into the 12, but I want you to write down personal responsibility. Repeat after me. We must do our part concerning our wealth and our health. Keep talking. Say this. If I don't manage my health, I will spend all of my wealth on it. My wife used to work up there at UAMS, and she would talk about the bags of money that people would get out the car with. I'm talking about bags of money to pay for these procedures and things for their wives or husbands or sons or daughters to have. Bags of money. Bags of money. Just put it on the desk. Please, let's just pay for this and get her in the circle. Because they were spending their wealth on their health. Would you raise your right hand? I declare unto you in your old age, you will not spend your wealth on your health. In Jesus' name. You turn around paying for prescriptions. You almost be driving in a Porsche paying out $900 in prescriptions. Amen. Paying back all the money you owe, all the surgeries. All right? I got one of my mothers, she called and touched talking about, I'm a biotonic woman. I said, what? What did you say? She said, honey, I got a new shoulder. I got two new knees. I got a new ankle. They replaced my hip. I said, I ain't gonna call your mother no more. I'm gonna call you iRobot. Every time you turn around, she's going to get a new song. I said, see if they can give you a biotonic, whatever. She said, hard. You just live for 1,000 years. And that's what they're doing now. The doctors are saying, let's just come on in here and replace it. By the way, here's another 100,000 young boys. Not so. Personal responsibility. 1 Corinthians 3:8-9 talks about it on this wise. Verse 8 says, look there. He says, he who plants and he who waters is what? One with the same purpose. And each will be what? Rewarded. Repeat after me, God's going to reward me. How many want God to reward you for your labor in the area of your health? Amen. So we're going to have to go walking, saints. We got to go walking. I'm going to talk about that after a while, about sweat. You don't know, put some jumps in, wrap yourself in plastic. Amen. Mama may have just push your wheelchair in the garage at 102 degrees on the kitchen. My mama know who my dad is. Okay. Keep on laughing, right? All right. Because you have to work with God. We are laborers with Him. You are God's field. You are God's building. All right? How many would say that if the code enforcer would come by to evaluate your building of health, how many of you would be condemned? Yeah, be condemned. Two things should that define this relationship that we need with God. Here it is. God will help provide the control, but you have to provide the cooperation. All right, just like some of y'all said, try that okra water. You like, man, oh, I ain't trying the okra water. All right, try walk twice this week, just 30 minutes, that's all. Take the stairs and stuff there, man. See, it's no need of wanting God to do His part, and you're not going to do yours. We just buried someone probably less than 6 months ago, and my mom knows it was one of our preachers, and who we loved dearly. He was an obese man. Now they said at the funeral, this would make me sad when I was sitting there, they said this, if he had to walk, these are the people that worked with him, if he had to work on the night shift and he had to walk from the main floor to the office, he would get on a forklift and drive the forklift all the way up to the door. This is what the lady's saying. I'm sitting there in the funeral doing this. Well, no wonder why his heart played out. The moment he went to walking, they say he would panic because he had all that weight on him. And by the time he walked about 30 paces, he started feeling lightheaded. I'm the bad guy. I'm just simply trying to tell you, somebody should have wrestled the fork out of his hand. It's all right to preach. Did y'all just see on the thing just yesterday at the preacher in South Africa? This man was preaching. Sat down in his chair. I'm talking about in the service. They say, hallelujah. He sat down in his chair, leaned back like this, and was dead. When they did the autopsy, they said the man was suffering from high blood pressure and his diabetic numbers were so high, he went into a coma. And they thought he passed out in the Holy Ghost. Go out there and research it. They got the man laying in the floor. They fanning him saying, oh, praise the Lord. He dead. And we are shouting and we are doing our business going back and we are not conscious that if God inventoried our physical building, would it be condemned? Say it with me. He provides the control. We provide work. Amen. Just turn around. Somebody say, can you please cooperate? Please. He's trying to give you long life. Isaiah 1:19. You know that. If you would be willing and obedient, you would eat the good of the land. If you would be. If you would be willing and obedient. God said, I got good things for you. Laying foundation. 1 Corinthians 1:24. But unto them which are called both Greeks and Jews, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Should I write that down? 1 Corinthians 1:24. But what's God's part concerning your health? He wants to do two things. First thing he wants to do is twofold. He wants to give you his power and he wants to give you his wisdom. Man, let me tell you something. I had a good meal today. It was great. Oh. But you know what that fasting did? Shrunk my belly. And let me tell you something. As fast as I ate that food, as fast as I got rid of it. I was like, Hey, y'all, I'll be back. My body said, get rid of that. Because the power, brothers and sisters, this is what the power of God is. The power of God is how to operate in the spirit, right? That's what it means to have the power of God flowing in your life. It's to be sensitive to how to operate in the spirit. Well, Pastor, if that's the power of God, then what was the wisdom of God that Christ gives? Well, the wisdom of God is how to live in the natural. You got to have both. Have y'all ever heard this phrase? Some people are so spiritually good, they're no earthly good. You've heard that before? One of the members was talking in Sunday school and was talking about, I said, how many of y'all want to turn out to be like your parents? And she didn't raise her hand. This is a true fact. And we came back and revisited us, and I said something else. I said, well, why did you raise your hand this time? She says, well, I would love to be everything my mama was in wisdom. I mean, in power. But I don't want to die her death. I said, how did she die? He said, she died real bad diabetic. Lost limbs and died. Watch this, before her time. She was anointed, but she couldn't control her stomach. So when the daughter assessed, did she want to be like a mother or live out like a mother? She said, no. She says, yes, in power, but not in wisdom. She could quote the word, but she couldn't control the fog. Amen. Say this with me. I want his power and I want his wisdom. Aging and sickness are not mutually exclusive. Just because you get old don't mean you get sick. Y'all hear what I'm telling you? Let me say, it's mutually exclusive. They don't go hand in hand. Opportunity to preach a revival down in Sparkman some years ago and stay with a lady by the name of Mother May Griffin. I mean, this lady, Mother, Kim, how old is Mother May Griffin? Now, Mother May Griffin is 98. Now, how old was Mother May Liza? Mother May Liza was 101. And the first thing that Mother May Liza said to me when I walked in her house, she said, "Boy, you fat." And God has been setting me up for this teaching for some years now, Eric. Because when I go around the old saints, and I'm thinking, man, and then she gonna tell me I blessed her in the service, but she had the first tell me, "You fat." And in my pride, this is what I said to her, Samantha. I said, "Mother, you just don't understand. I eat real good." And so she saw she struck a nerve with me, and she didn't say nothing else. I look back on it, I owe her an apology. I was so controlled by my appetite, I felt I needed to say that to her. I should have accepted the truth. I was fat. Close to 300 pounds. Dressed up in I got 300 pounds in a $2,000 suit. And I'm chosen to preach. It still don't change the fact I'm fat. I'm trying to help somebody. And I pray this helps somebody because we have too many people. Y'all know we be at services and then somebody say, "I went to the doctor, my sugar was 900. Hold your say, "Oh!" They tried to give me that medicine. I told them I'm walking by faith. No, Negro. You have all the faith you want. You better get that medicine in you because you're going to be walking around here and have a stroke or a heart attack. Because you are not going to change your eating in no 2 days. Y'all going to walk with me? Almost through. Next slide. 12 keys to living without sickness. And I'm going to take my time, and I'm coming to the end. I'm 7 minutes away, and I'm going to retire for the night. And I believe you've already learned some things. Let me ask you this. Does God want you healthy? Yes. Does God care about your emotional system? Yes. What does your emotional system do to the way that you eat? It affects it. What's God promised over your life? Long life. He wants you to live a long time. What can hinder you doing it? 1 Corinthians 11:29 said, the lack of what? It starts with D. Discernment. No honor to your body. How many treat your house like the best, but treat your body like crap? You know that's possible, don't you? Mm-hmm. I got relatives that was like that. I got an auntie, she just passed. You walk in the house, it was first class. The furniture was first class. Everything was first class. She was clean. But the way she treated her body was with no discernment. And for that reason, she's gone today. Smoke, eat anything. It didn't matter what it was, just put some barbecue sauce on it. Drunk Pepsis every day. Pepsis and sodas and cigarettes. Cigarettes and sodas. Cigarettes and sodas. This woman has an immaculate home. But her body or her temple was horrible. Y'all see what I'm trying to tell you? 12 keys to living without sickness. Let's do 5 minutes. Let's do the first one. Number one is the disease factor. 99% of sickness is created by man. Repeat after me, do not invite sickness into your body. Now, if the Lord forgave you of all your sins, then why are we so sick? The Bible says we have to give an answer on that day because all sins now, since Christ saved your soul, is against one thing. What is that? Against the body. Okay? It's against the body. Now, I just already taught you earlier, what did I tell you? When God wanted to kill humanity and lower the age that they would live, what did he introduce them to? Meat. They used to live 900 years old. When they started eating meat, they died at 70. It actually went to 120 and then went down to 70. Genesis 6, man thought about evil continually to do it in his heart. So when they got out in the wilderness, they said, we don't want your mammon. So what do you want? We want chitlins. We want frog legs, because that's what they ate in Egypt. He said, you guys out here won't even feed us. Moses brought us out here to kill us. That's the song they were singing. And it ticked God off. Moses said, no, no, God. God said, no, let me at him, Moses. Get out the way. And then God said, I'll tell you what I'll do. Not only do I want them to have enough meat for a day, but I want them to have enough meat for a month in a day. And them gluttons ate their food. The Bible says meat started coming out of their nose like hamburger meat. Like that over there in Maori nose now. Chicken just coming out of their nose. And it made them sick. How many of you, by showing hands, it's hard to eat vegetables? Hard to eat vegetables. 1, 2, 3. Hard to eat vegetables. Now let me ask y'all this. Did your folks make a lot of it when you were young, when you come up? Didn't make you eat it. I'm talking about they didn't make y'all eat it. Greens. They make you eat greens? No. Green beans, vegetables, peas. Made you eat it. Now y'all are the older tribulation here. Y'all had to pick them and eat them. Where my black peas eaters at right here, see? Purple hood. They even say you can't even cross over from December to January without a bowl of purple hood peas. Black eyed peas. Somebody had them balling January the 1st. Had to have a black eyed peas, and you had to have at least a man Negro to walk through the house to bless it. They come up with all that stuff, yo. Y'all ain't gonna say, man, I know I'm right about it. You didn't come by the house, Pastor, walk in my house. What for now? The old folks taught that. Disease is the disease factor, right? And people are dying from disease, but make this notation, there is a healing for every disease. And I'm just not talking about spiritual. I'm talking about natural. And I got a book I'm reading now. I'm going to get ready to onslaught a whole lot of stuff to you that is just going to be for you who come to this class, this seminar. It's going to be healing techniques and principles that I'm going to teach you. Man said he went to the doctor. They told him he was going to die. He went to see a health guy who specialized in herbs. Guy gave him something. Started reversing his condition. He went to the doctors and they ran the test again and said, we must have misdiagnosed you. He said, why y'all can't say that I'm healed from it? He said, because that, sir, we cannot tell you. And he wrote a book about it, saying that all they wanted me to do was accept my sickness and die. But because I was healed, they don't want nobody to know. They would rather say you never had it than to say you had it and God healed. Y'all know what I'm saying? All right? And then he put in there, taking chemo is the devil. Number two, that's D. D is the disease factor. Number two, and I'm done. Elimination. I want to close talking about waste. Removing waste from the body. That's what elimination is. You should boo-boo at least 2 to 3 times a day. If it don't come out, it'll come up. I ain't gonna throw up, Pastor. No, it'll be in the smell of your breath. And I'll be like, what did you say? How was your pleasure? Woo! It'll come out under your arms and your hormones. Somebody be close to you, smell like poop. I'ma help y'all tonight. I just got out the shower, it ain't me. no, it ain't that the soap is not working. It's, it can't stand up to the bile that's coming out of your arm. It'll come out of your fat. Some of you take your own sweat off, you can't even smell an arm, but you're like, ooh. And not all of that is musk, it's bile. Because that body has to secrete and get that off of it. Otherwise, it'll come up. Can I help you? How many times does a baby boo-boo? About 7 to 10 times a day, right? You want to know why? That's the healthiest that gut will ever be. See, when your gut healthy, you excrete waste away from it. Again, if you didn't make the note earlier, every 3 hours, you should be able to secrete that food from it. And it says this, I'm going to teach you that even though some foods that you like to eat, you need to put certain spices and certain things on top of it. Right? They help you. A little garlic and certain things that help stir that stomach up to help get that food off of it. But just eating it plain and eating it with nothing and that food staying in your stomach a long time is unhealthy. Okay? So you have to remove waste from that body. A baby probably pooped 4 to 5 times a day or sometimes more than that. God never meant, say this with me, God never meant food to stay in the body more than 3 hours. You know where sickness comes from? Decayed food that's been in your body too long. That's where sickness comes from. Sickness comes from food that has stayed too long. Sickness comes from food that stays too long. And when it stays into your body too long, you have gas problems. When the gut can't get rid of you, just start winning. And some of you know when you get them good winds, you know something is destructive coming. If you ever can get it to come down, you like this, woo. You be in there rocking like this. Some tornado is coming your way. Hey, amen. And don't get that $1 spray either. You're gonna need Febreze. And y'all quiet, a little bleach beside it, everything. Alright? That's what happens when food stays in your body. Fermentation is called fermentation. And that's when you start doing a lot of winning. Not winning like a game, but breaking wind. Okay? I'm closing when I tell you you need to stop eating certain foods, and I'll give it to you. And I know some of you gonna do it, but write this down. These foods block my intestines. Ready, Mari? Anything made from flour. Anything made from flour. I'll come back later and show you how much salt is in bread. There's enough salt in bread that it'll kill a pea. These foods block your intestines. It's bread, donuts, meat and wheat. Meat and wheat. And for those who have blood problem, blood thing, meat is and bread is not good for your body because it inflames the body. It causes your ankles and things to swell and cause your inflammatory system to be going cold orange. Like I'm explaining that like security intestine, it raises up fluid. See, I stuff that, then water is not naturally flowing the way that it should. So it starts to build in my feet and in my ankles and my hands, see? Because that intestine is blocked. That's why when you fast, if you got rings on when you fast, what happened? Man, I was talking when I was fast and my ring went flying across the room. I was like, man! You start losing weight in your hands. Why? You don't have all that bread in you. I just helped you. If you eat bread, you gotta eat it in moderation. Because that bread will stuff your intestine. And then you come behind that. I was eating with one of the brothers from Houston. And he said that, and y'all know Red Lobster's the devil. They feed you all that bread. Ooh, it'd be good too. Don't go to Cork and think you eat all them warm buns with that, ooh, with that honey. Somebody hit the organ. And you, here it is. It's a trick. Because if you sit there and eat all that bread and then put that food on that, it's going to make you miserable. And then some of us, give me another Coke. I seen a woman belch. She was like, whoo. Well, what she was trying to do was that acid is what she needed to try to break up some of that bread. Really, because bread will suffocate you. My buddy from Houston was eating all that bread, ate hot wings. I'm talking about some of the spicy wings. To the point, man, he started throwing up right there. We was eating at one of them fancy places called the Cheesecake Factory. And man, he put that spicy stuff on there, was drinking that water and stuff like that. Man, he got sick. And when I just started studying this stuff and saw, I said, all his intestine was blocked. And when that spicy stuff needed to go down here, it didn't. It stayed here. And it irritated his esophagus so bad he had to throw it up. Made the people think that something was wrong with the food, and it wasn't. I close when I tell you this. Vegetables are your friends. Remember this. Bread, donuts, meat, wheat. Write this down, don't have legs. Say that with me, they don't have legs. Your intestine is 9 feet. That's long, that's, if I laid out 9 feet of coil right here, you say that's pretty long. Your food has to make it through those 9 feet to come out your behind. If you eat foods that don't have any legs, then something has to try to force that food through that intestine all the way down. Vegetables have legs. They run right through your intestine. But meat don't. Bread don't. Donuts don't. Wheat don't. You need vegetables in everything that you eat to help give something with some legs. Just add vegetables to your diet. You'll see that stomach will stay rumbling and tumbling. Collard greens and cabbage. Those are what is called, when I say legs, I'm talking about they have fiber. They have fiber that grips the intestine. It grips on the inside of the intestines and forces through those 9 meters long. You need food with fiber. Say that with me. I need food with fiber. Two things you can always add to your food if you like these two things. That's coconut and pecan. If you just add that to a little bit of everything that you eat, it'll help you. Move that food through your intestine because you don't want it to stay there too long. Right? White rice is not good for you. Potatoes, not good for you. Brown rice is more healthy than white rice. Wild rice is more healthy than them all. You want to know why? Because it has a shaft on the end of it. See, when they make white rice, they take the shaft off of it. Now, which is more healthy, the shaft or the rice? The shaft is the part you're really supposed to eat. They just figured out in the last decade or so, I'll say like that, that the healthiest part of eating a potato, a baked potato, is the skin. Y'all missing this. Because it's vitamin D in it. The sun that baked this potato and turned it brown got all of the nutrients in it. And what did we do for years? We took off the healthy part. Y'all help me here. Put butter in it. Butter. I ain't talking about that regular butter. I put butter in it, all this other stuff, and made it something, and then none of it's healthy. Because the most healthy part of life is the chaff. If it don't have chaff, then watch this. It is proven that you eat a lot of rice without the chaff, it increases your risk of diabetes. Wow. Because there's no fiber, anything nutritious in it. It's just white rice. And we hadn't known none of this stuff for years. How many of y'all grew up eating white rice at least 2-3 times a week? Oh Lord, yes. Didn't we, Mom? White rice. And none of this is not healthy. We're gonna have you on that diet that one time, man, with that brown rice. I'll give me a take it down to the city. That brown rice about killed me. Ain't got no flavor to it. I hated that brown rice. She's sitting over there eating the little things and come like this. I said, this is nasty. It don't matter what you add to brown rice, it's nasty. It's just nasty. But watch this. Things that are white are not good for you black folk. Did y'all get that?
Yeah.
Touch your neighbor, and I'm saying this on national TV. Just touch your neighbor and say, are you colored?
Are you colored?
Tell them, I give you permission
to be prejudiced
in your food.
In
your food only. Salt, sugar, white rice, white potatoes, white bread, all this stuff is bad for you. So this week, try to put some beans on this week. Put some beans on. But one thing about beans, you ain't got to tell beans when they need to leave you. Them beans says, naked I came in, and naked I'm getting out. And all the reason we ate, only reason I ate brown beans, I just tell you, because they put sugar on and mixed it with some cornbread. All the reason I ate white beans, because they put sugar on it and put mix it with a little ketchup. All reason I ate white potatoes that were sauteed because they put jelly on. They taught me all these bad habits. And I'm trying to get you to undo them so you can live just a little longer. And many women in here, I want to say this, who control your kitchen and cook for people that you love. God wants to increase your wisdom so you can cause the people who eat from your table a little bit. My little son coming in, my baby boy coming in, saying, look, Dad, lost 13 pounds on the fast. I said, you sexy now, ain't you? Because he loved to eat. And I like to close with my family, just keep laughing. We was in there, he said, I know we on the fast. He said, but I would just like some white rice. I said, you want some white rice? Oh, if I could. And I say all it to be comical, but the fast has really brought healing and perspective to our eating in our home. And my prayer is for each and every one of you is that you will have something to pass down, not your anointing, not your tongue talking, your saying, but you pass down a good waistline. And healthy eating. Amen. How many of y'all knew what Whole Foods was when it first came out? I didn't. I just saw white folk going to a grocery store. That black, I ain't seen no black folks in no Whole Foods store when they, and they had learned something among their own culture they wasn't gonna tell us. Organic food. And the first thing we thought we went in that being nosy was this food high. I can get this at Kroger, especially in the man of choice section. That's us. That's how we think. And here's the statistics. Black people died 11 years prior to the average white person. I'm on the plane and I'm sitting by all kind of Caucasian folk. And when the man come through there, what do you want? They said, water. What do you want? Water. Looked at me, I said, man, I want some cranberry. But give me some water too. Because they have tapped into that your body's made up of 70% water. And when your body's dry, how many went that wings? And I'm talking about the dry brain with that cerebral fluid run out. Dry brain saints, I'm talking about that. Well, that's what happened. When your body's dry and don't have appropriate water in it, it starts to dysfunction. Start having urinary tract infections and certain things like that because you're not hydrated. And when you take medicine, medicine absorbs water. So you may think you're drinking a lot of water, but it ain't. Because that medicine is sucking that water. So you have to drink almost two. I didn't have enough water. Sick of water. Don't get sick of water. Because that's what you made of. I went going and get rid of a whole case in a whole week. That's how much water you need. I even heard when you increase your water, it increases the strength of your kidneys. Father, we love
you. Oh. Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be?